Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining what is the inaugural George Mason University Mechanical Design Capstone Day. We are very grateful for your time and interest and appreciate the support of our sponsors, of the technical advisors, and the industry board members. The first project to be presented here today relates to the design and fabrication of a portable wind turbine. The artifacts are there to the side of the stage. This effort was sponsored by the Technical Data Analysis Corporation of Falls Church. Juan Canedo leads the team. And given the rotational velocity of the wind turbine blades, what was particularly impressive is that very few fingers and almost no other body parts were chopped off as they executed the testing process. So with that, we'll turn it over to Mr. Canedo and his team.
Thank you, Professor Gallo, for that introduction. Hello, everybody. My name is Juan Canedo, and this is my team, Team Aeolus. Our team members are Caroline Diedrichs, who's in charge of data and communications, Steve Parasitis, who's in charge of our electrical systems, David Podlock, who is heading our mechanical systems, and last but not least, Mr. James Treewasser, who is our aerodynamics expert. The scope of this project was to work with TDA to build a small-scale wind turbine. But the difference with this small-scale wind turbine is that we wanted to utilize as much additive manufacturing, which is really hot right now, but use as much of that to construct the overall, I guess, wind turbine. Some technical requirements that they had were that the diameter of the blades not exceed 5 feet. The cut-in speed, which is the rate at which the turbine starts to spin, be below 2.5 meters per second. The structure itself be only weigh, 8.8 pounds. That the blades produce 300 watts at ideal peak power. That included in the system be a 30,000 milliamp battery. And that we utilize topology optimization, again, additive manufacturing, numerical simulation of our data and our performance, and also incorporate a control system, which we'll discuss later as pitch control. So a little bit of background, I guess, of the wind energy machines. They're split up in two categories. One category is the way in which they extract energy from the wind and convert it to mechanical, then electrical energy. The second category is basically the axis of rotation. So any wind turbine or wind energy machine is a combination of these two categories. This is the overall wind turbine and the systems that we incorporated in ours. Now, the larger wind turbines that you see on wind farms, they incorporate a whole lot more subsystems and they're more complex. In addition, or the only difference, I guess, between the large scale and the small scale that we've built is that we don't have a yaw mechanism because our wind turbine is so lightweight that it can just head itself into the wind. In addition to that, the only other subsystem that you don't see represented on ours that you do see represented on a large scale wind turbine is a gearbox. And that's just because they're trying to rotate as much, as much torque as possible to produce as much current electricity. So to kick off, we'll talk about, I guess, our tower, the structure. Just reiterating the fact that we wanted to build a small scale, semi-portable wind turbine and, we utilized as much additive manufacturing as possible. The bottom line was that additive manufacturing would only take us so far. The actual cylindrical tubes that you see on the legs, the supports, and the tower itself, and the upper tower, they were all constructed with hand-laid fiber that we laid here in-house. And the hinges, the knuckles, the slide pins, and the slide collars, those are all additive manufacturing produced and took many, many iterations of that to do. So overall, we gained a 3.5 pound decrease in weight by utilizing carbon fiber in our design process. The next subsystem that we developed was the blades. We actually produced or 3D printed our blades. We were constrained by the size of our 3D printer. But we found pretty unique and creative methods in joining those parts together. In the long run, though, we found it better, I guess, and more aesthetically pleasing to purchase blades that are 3D printed from a retailer. But the design, everything was all our doing. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to David Podlock, who's going to talk to you about the development of the design of the blades.
Thank you, JC. So when developing the blade, we had a multi-step process. We started off with finding the initial parameters of the blade. We then transitioned into making a design of the blade, which we then tested in the wind tunnel. After that, we made adjustments to that wind blade based on the wind tunnel results, and then finally fabricated the blade using additive manufacturing. When designing a blade, it is important to choose the proper airfoil for our application. When choosing an airfoil, we focus on the low Reynolds number range performance, as well as previous wind turbine applications. In addition to that, we looked at the coefficient of lift and drag ratios across a wide range of angles of attack. This narrowed down our selection to three airfoils: the A18 airfoil, the SG series airfoil, and the NREL series airfoils. We then took those airfoils and produced blades in a software called QBlade. QBlade allowed us to analyze the deflection of the blade, the weight of the blade, and the low wind speed performance. Taking that criteria into consideration, we determined that the NREL blades were most suited for our applications. It was by far the strongest blade and also produced the most startup torque. When designing the NREL airfoils, we had three different profiles. The S835 is a root airfoil, the S833 is a primary airfoil, and the S834 is a tip airfoil. We then interpolated those airfoils between their respective positions. Blade radius was determined by the rated power, which is 300 watts, the rated wind speed, which we determined to be 12 meters per second, and system efficiency. For the system efficiency, we went with a very conservative estimate of around 25%. This gave us a radius of 0.6 meters. We then determined the cord and twist distribution of the blade using the tip speed ratio, the number of blades, the lift coefficient, and the blade radius. We then simulated the blades in QBlade. Our main criteria was to shift the torque curve to the lowest possible wind speed. This was because we want a very low cutting speed of well below the 2.5 meters per second requested by our sponsors. In the end, we are able to produce a wind turbine that produces 300 watts at around 450 RPM. Now I'll hand it off to James, who will talk about our wind tunnel results.
Thank you, sir. All right, so as David mentioned, simulation was a very important aspect of our blade design process, but the next step was validation. So we needed to prove all the information that we learned from QBlade, so the geometry as well as performance. We were fortunate enough to have access to wind tunnel via the Naval Academy. They were gracious enough to offer us their access to the facility during three separate tests. The first step of wind tunnel testing is to scale down your blades. Based on the Reynolds numbers that we're dealing with, which was below 500,000, we used Reynolds number matching. The reason we didn't use geometric scaling is because it would involve impossibly large rotational velocities. So what that means for Reynolds matching is that the small scale scale model is rotating 9 times faster than our full scale model. That led to a lot of implications in wind tunnel testing, meaning at very low speeds, we're rotating very, very, very quickly. So just to give you an example, at 400 meters per second, we're rotating at 2,000 RPM. You can see we did three wind tunnel tests. You can see our progression of the blades. So the first wind tunnel test is these gray points. It's far below the RPM versus wind velocity, our theoretical curve. Our theoretical curve was generated based on an assumed tip speed ratio of 4.2. You can see the reason for that, the blades were meant to be indexed at negative 6, 0, and 6 degrees. They were not negative 6, 0, and 6 degrees based on, so that describes this discrepancy. We had two remaining tests, so wind tunnel 2, we addressed this discrepancy and we got much better data. You can see that in test 2, our RPMs were actually higher than our theoretical curve. So that boded very well for us. When tunnel test 3, we added capability, so we had an Arduino as an RPM counter. It tracked the change in rotation over time in an attempt to graph torque. So we actually used this information to create this lovely power versus wind velocity. So this is the thing that every manufacturer is going to show you. It's going to show you it's going to say at what wind velocity and what power you're making. So fortunately for us, the projected cut-in speed was below our technical specified of 2.5 meters per second. It was at 2. You'll also notice at 10.2 meters per second, right here, we are making in excess of 300 watts. So that is the point at which pitch control will start regulating the power and level off up until our cutout speed. Carrie will touch on that later on in the presentation. All right, so the next step in the blade design process is structural optimization. This was done through finite element analysis, FEA. FEA was conducted to determine the appropriate wall thickness. You may or may not have noticed that our blades are hollow. And they need to operate over a large wind speed range. So that's between 0 and all the way up to 25 meters per second. They need to do this, and they need to be as light as possible. So that's where a finite element comes in. So we used a program called Solid Edge. We lofted across 20 different sections in a solid model and then hauled them out and had 5 separate sections and assembled them into a single file. So what we did, we looked at the force of lift, and it was applied at 2/3 the length from the root at 25 meters per second, our worst case scenario. You can see this diagram over here, and we applied the force of lift in the Z direction, so coming up in this direction, along the top surface of the blade. We applied a factor safety of 2, so meaning it was 40-pound force, so we applied 80-pound force distributed load. The yield stress was calculated experimentally based on tensile testing, and the remaining properties, so Young's modulus, Poisson's ratio, were determined from the technical specifications of the manufacturer of PLA. The next step, my personal favorite, fabrication. So that's why we're here. We love to build. We're mechanical engineers. So we quite wisely decided to outsource our blades in addition to creating our own blade. The reason for that, the printer quality of the printers available to us, which is the MakerBot Replicator Plus, they're overworked and they're overtired, so the printer quality is eh. The in-house blades we shipped to or sent designed to a company called iMaterialize all the way in Belgium. They printed the blades using a method called laser sintering. The only reason I mention this, it's a little bit different than the method we used, which is fused deposition modeling. We heat filament. They use a laser to basically lay a layer of powder and then melt it with a laser, built upon layer, thousands upon layers later, we get those lovely white blades prominently displayed on our wind turbine. The home-built blades, those are blue blades to my left. They are actually, they're capable of being assembled and disassembled. The reason for that, not only is that extremely handy and meets our technical requirement for being slightly more man-portable, it is that because the printer bed, where we had a constraint of 11 and a half inches. So they're actually fastened using bolts and nuts. They're actually slightly lighter than our projected blades. What I failed to mention was that prior to finite element, we had a constant cross-section, and it weighed 1.5 pounds. Using finite element analysis, we were able to get down to 0.72 pounds. So we halved the weight. So you'll notice that the collar here, it is 0.160 inches at the root, all the way to 0.05 inches to the tip. So we used finite element for that. And now we'll hand it off to JC to talk about the hub.
James Treadwasser, ladies and gentlemen. Our next slide, or the next subsystem, I guess, that we're going to talk about is going to be the rotor hub. The rotor hub is what the blades connect to. This is the bare minimum, I guess, of the rotor hub, just to show you, I guess, the level of complexity or the progression. The rotor hub houses our pitch control system, which gets more complicated with our Arduino-based system. And what pitch control system does is basically it allows, I guess, us to twist or change, I guess, the angle of attack of our blades in order to meet the either desired rotational speed in the wind speed that we're in and produce the amount of power that we want. Incorporated within our pitch control system is our braking system. So we didn't have an actual mechanical brake. We used a positive angle of attack to create a stalling condition, which would lower the rotation of our wind turbine. So more to talk to you about that, I'm going to hand it over to Carolyn Diedrichs.
So as JC mentioned, the pitch control system for variable speed horizontal wind turbines. They use pitch control to achieve a constant power production. The design pitch control system has a task of adjusting the angle of attack of the blades by monitoring and regulating the rotational speed of the generator. This was achievable in our case with the use of a photosensor, which is a highly sensitive device whose purpose is to measure the rotational speed or the RPMs, or the amount of interrupts, which you can see is demonstrated out on the small test rig on the table. When compared to the previous power versus RPM graph, the steady state graph demonstrates how the pitch control works with the power production, so how it affects the power production. With focusing on the 300 watts desired by the sponsors given our technical requirements, that rated power will be achievable at roughly 450 RPMs, which is our rated output speed for the control system. Now, the control system has three subsystems: motor configuration, prevention protocol, and steady state logic system. The motor configuration is the initial recognition system for the motor setup upon startup, and this will allow the motor to recognize what position it's in. This will only be implemented upon electrical malfunctions or emergency shutdowns. The prevention protocol is a preventive method to avoid damage to the wind turbine in cases of exceeding high RPMs. It will pitch to a safety pitch setting, effectively creating stall position, which is the braking system that JC had mentioned earlier. For the steady state logic system, the microcontroller regulates the difference or the error between the measured rotor speed input and the desired rotor speed input, and then produces that pitch that's necessary to eliminate that error, which then is our rated position for the control. And it is demonstrated in this schematic diagram. So many systems were under consideration in the preliminary design process. Our team decided on an active pitch control because of its desired performance in small-scale wind turbines and performing in low wind speeds. As you can see in the configuration, it is a simple bevel gear and bearing assembly, and the motor is, and the receiver system is attached inside the nose cone, attached to a center gear that will rotate all the blades. It has a quick detachability method for ease of access and for maintenance purposes. So the servo plate, the blades, the gears, and the nose cone are all detachable for user friendliness. Structural analysis was also done on the blades, but also the gears and the shafts, which done in finite element analysis and fusion, which also created minor changes in our design. So the 3D printed blades were not strong enough to take the forces from the wind. So we ordered nylon blades, which held true to a safety factor of 2.6. And this allowed our pitch control system to effectively monitor and regulate the power production created through the generator, which Steve will now talk about.
Hello. I'm going to talk a little bit about what I'd like to refer to as the heart of the turbine, or in other words, the generator. Generator is pretty important. It's got to produce the power, so definitely would like to focus a little bit on that. To satisfy our clients, the technical data analysis, it was important to make sure that the generator was both reliable and very powerful for our needs. Referring back to the initial requirements that were given to us in the statement of work, we focused on a couple different characteristics, primarily the weight being manageable, making sure that it was able to produce 300 watts of power or greater, and that it would start up producing power, or in other words, the cut-in speed at 2.5 meters per second. We were able to do that by looking at a couple different generators online. But I will mention or note that it was very difficult because most of the retailers online gave false advertisements. So as you will see in a little bit, we went through quite a different options to come up to one at the end. Speaking of which, pictured here is our final generator that we ended up with, specifically built for wind turbines. There's a power output curve there to show visually a representation. I apologize, it got cut off at the bottom, but I'll vocally explain. It shows that approximately 2.53 meters per second is when we start producing power, just as is mentioned in the requirements, and it'll continue to produce power actually well above the 300 watts that was initially stated. So moving on, as I mentioned, we looked through a couple different generator options. We primarily looked at a couple characteristics, such as the weight, the RPMs in it, which it would be producing power. That is important because depending on the amount of wind speed, our turbine rotor could be spinning at a different RPM and it wouldn't match. In addition, we were looking at weight. We couldn't have something too heavy, obviously, and power output. This is an overall schematic of our system, or in particular, our power management system. It starts off with the generator at front, produces the power. From there, it moves to a charge controller we have within the nacelle, or the top part of the turbine. I will be referring to the physical turbine. From the charge controller, it can go two paths. If too much power is being produced from the generator, it will go to a heat sink, which acts as a resistor and expels the excess power through heat. The remaining power, or power that is below the limit, will go to a digital reader. It will visually show the user how much voltage is being produced, the current, and the power that is being produced as well. From there, it'll go through a diode to make sure that the current is being flowed one direction and not to reverse and come back, and then end up and be stored in the battery. From the battery, there is an inverter. It's a device that changes direct current to usable AC current so the user can charge devices such as their laptop, phones, et cetera. Here's a visual representation of a quick detachable collar system that we designed. Again, referring back to the wind turbine, it's on the very top of the tower at the neck. It's very user-friendly, intuitive. All it requires is just pulling down on some tabs, rotation, and release. There's a male and female key there. And the point of it was to allow the user to quickly assemble this in the field, requiring no tools or any hard maintenance there. It is completely 3D printed. And then finally, touch on the battery and storage system. It's a 120-volt battery. It has fuse links, quick detachable terminals, and a couple of USB ports for the user to charge their devices through. It's a little bit heavy, but provides the 300 watts that that was stated in the statement of work and fulfills that requirement. Now I'll move on to budget, and JC will talk about that.
So we get to the exciting stuff here now. The budget. So we received two budgets, one from TDA, Technical Data Analysis, and one from Georgia Mason University. So the brass tacks, we're under budget. We came in at $2,100, just over $2,100, which our budget for TDA was $2,500. We've broken down everything that we've spent per our subsystems. I just want to reiterate the fact that we had a lot of subsystems that required multiple iterations of design, fabrication, so that's where most of the money was spent on. The funding that we received from George Mason was spent, I guess, on the larger purchases. The blades that we sent out to get printed through the retail shop, those were pretty hefty, over $1,100. But included in that, we got a free keychain, so that's always good. Like I said, we were underneath budget, and we came in at a total of $3,200 with our budget of $5,000. So overall, it was a success. We achieved all of the technical requirements that were set forward. It was difficult and we came in close, but our rotor diameter is below 5 feet. It comes into about 4.7 or 4.8 feet. Through QBlade, we validated that our cut-in speed is well below 2.5 meters per second. Our weight of our structure, which doesn't include the generator and the obviously heavy battery, is a little bit over. We're at 8.89 pounds, but hopefully we'll get a little bit of wiggle room there. Yeah, maybe not. So the technical requirement also, I guess, stated that we produce a 30,000 milliamp battery. We went way over that, and the reason for that is because a 30,000 milliamp battery, even though it's lightweight and it's portable, it doesn't provide, I guess, 300 watts for a long time. So if you're trying to utilize those 300 watts, you really want something a little bit bigger than that. Again, 300 watts we validated through QBlade when we scaled up the data that we received from the wind tunnel and we scaled it up to the large scale. We definitely use a lot of additive manufacturing. And we understand that the reason, I guess, TDA wanted additive manufacturing involved in this project was that you can go through many, many iterations at a very cheap price. What you see here is many hours, I guess, of work, hard work, and many, many iterations of design, and everything like that. So it's only through additive manufacturing that we can do those iterations and get to where we are today. So on behalf of my team and myself, I'd like to thank you for your time, for listening to us, and we'll answer any questions, I guess, that you have right now, or anything like that.